Welcome back.
I'm praying for rain in California so the grapes can grow and they can make more wine. And I'm sitting in a honky in Chicago with a broken heart and a woman on my mind. I'm asked the man behind the bar for the jukebox, and the music takes me back to Tennessee. And they ask, who's the fool in the corner crying? I say, Charles Dubron's lost out. God damn it, man. Week 16, UFC 300 just went past Maron. Broken hearts, new champions. Last week, I'm down in Nashville, 'cause my baby left for Florida on a train. I thought I'd get a job and just forget her, but in Chicago, the broken heartache still the same. Still the same, man. I'm asked the man behind the bar for the jukebox, and the music takes me back to Tennessee. And they ask, who's the fool in the corner crying? I say, Justin just went out in the fifth round. A little old wine drink of me. UFC week 16, ballin' at what cost?
Here we are. New week, new events, new history has been forged last weekend. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm Orexi Bukanik, and we're balling today, tomorrow, and most definitely yesterday. At what cost? UFC 300. History has been made. It has been etched in the books, in the history books. I'm sure someone wrote a book already about what has happened over the past 48 hours, but we're going to break it down, okay? People can write books, people can write essays and articles about what happened. Here it is. Here's the purest form. You're going to get the reports here on Ballin' at What Cost with Orexi Bukanik. Guys, it's Monday. Guys, I'm going to get straight into it, okay? Week 16. We've officially made it. We keep the ball rolling. And this is what we do, guys. Big things can happen, but after these big things happen, we just keep it fucking going, man. We process what went down, and then we look on to the next thing, okay? It never stops, guys. Never stops. Bam, 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 boom, 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 okay? UFC 300. I could say a lot of heads went bam, 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 boom, boom, boom. I could tell you that. From the beginning, it was just, you can feel that it was a big thing. This was like a big thing that was happening. Early prelims, like I said, this fight card was stacked from beginning to end. But because of that, dude, the stadium was alive from the get-go. There was no silence ever. There was always a crowd cheering for the fights that were going on because the names were undeniable. The names were too big. And it just comes to show you, UFC's been long enough doing their thing that, you know, you can't help but notice these legendary fighters giving their best. So we're going to kick it off with Davison Figueiredo, one of the modern Brazilian lighter weight class savages. And he gets the submission win over Cody No Love Garbrandt in round two, barely gave Cody No Love a chance. Cody was giving it his best, but Davison very fast, very technical, very tricky to figure out. And once he trips you up, takes you down, and he's got a hold of you, is very difficult to get out. Round two was basically that. Round two was just Davison being a freaking Brazilian python, squeezing the love out of No Love, I'll tell you that much. And that was it. Round two submission, Davison Figueiredo. I don't need to say more. Upper weight class, looks dangerous as ever. He's going to keep it going, probably trying to go all the way to the top of the 135 division. Congrats to him. And just to show you that this evening will be full of finishes. It ain't no boring fights, or it kind of sets the pace for the rest of the... If the first fight is already around to finish, then what else can happen? And that's when we get into Bobby Green, who goes against the legendary Jim Miller. These both men have been around for more than... Oh, Jesus. Bless me. Thank you. Anyways, both men have been in the fucking company for more than a decade, and now they matched up against each other. Jim Miller, legendary, been in UFC 100, 200, and now 300. And Bobby Green show why you cannot count him out in terms of him just, reaching the end of his career and he's just, you know, doing a little bit of damage, doing a little bit of gatekeeping, finding the up and comers. But not, this is what he does to even the veterans. All right, he's done it already to a couple up and comers. Now he's shown you that he can do it to the veterans too, man. It don't matter nothing for Bobby Green, man. He kept a gangster. I'm not throwing gang signs, I swear. He kept the gangster. Yeah. He just outboxed freaking bam, bam, bam. Shell roll, fucking outclass Jim Miller. Beat up Jim Miller. Jim Miller showing why he's been in the company for so many years. Just taking the beating, not giving up, not backing down. Always trying his best to throw a little bit something back. But Jim Miller got a little bit outclassed right there by Bobby Green. Bobby Green definitely happy after that performance. Definitely still showing that he's nowhere near getting out of the UFC. He's here to stay. And that was just perfect. Perfect kind of show of heart from both gentlemen. And no bad blood at all. Just two legends doing what they do best. Next up, Jessica Andrade. And by at this point, guys, I'm 2 for 2 for picks, all right? You got to keep that in mind. We go into the next fight. It's Jessica Andrade goes against Marina Rodriguez. Both women put it quite on the line. They were really like Marina Rodriguez. It was first. She was pushing the pace a little bit, quite successful with keeping the distance, staying active. Jessica a little bit overwhelmed, but then as soon as Jessica put on the veteran experience of let's make this a dirty fight, let's make this a freaking just clinch exchange, close exchanges, then Marina got a little bit overwhelmed. She got a little bit nervous. It was a little too much for her in that moment. And because of that, Jessica was always able to get a bit of an edge. As soon as she made it closed in on the distance, got in the clinch, then it was bam, bam, bam. Jessica did the damage. She's right there. Yeah, you know, I know, you know, you could make fun of her, say she got T-Rex arm, but as soon as those T-Rex arms connect, it's a different story. Marina got rocked multiple times, and I think that's what ultimately got Jessica Andrade the split decision win over Marina Rodriguez after 3 rounds in the cage, in the octagon. Like I said, you can never count Jessica Andrade out. Even if she if it looks like she's going to be overwhelmed with distance or size, now, I don't know what to tell you guys. It ain't Jessica's first rodeo, and she's a beast. She is quite an unstoppable force. It takes a lot out of you if you want to stop her on her tracks, and that's me going 3-for-3 in the UFC 300 while I was watching. Next up, last fight of the early prelims, Renato Moicano. Money Moicano goes against the dangerous Jalen Turner. Jalen Turner shows off the threat that he poses constantly. Round one, first 30 seconds, body kick, front kick to the teeps Renato, and Renato got hurt straight into the liver. He got hurt. He somehow fought off Jalen Turner, fought off the finish. And then Jalen Turner, another crazy hook, lands flush, knocks Renato Moicano down, doesn't go in for the kill. No, Jalen, no, man, he don't go in for the kill, man. He ain't going for... Oh, man, that's just... That's like if you got the fish on the hook and you don't reel it in. What are you doing, kid? I know you got... It's right there. It's on the hook. Just reel it in. You got to finish the job. Jalen. Oh my God, dude. You're so dangerous. You're so it's like he's a fucking hippo. Potamus, dude. It's like, yeah, he could just destroy motherfuckers in seconds, but you know, every now and then he's lazy. He's like, you know, I had a big old lunch already. I already knocked out Bobby Green like that. Why would I have to, you know, finish off Renato Moicano, right? I deserve the one punch knockout, walk away, bonus knockout. That just hurts to see, man. It hurts to see, and then it plays in Money Moicano's favor. All right, Renato Moicano survives the brutality of the first round, gets the rest in between round one and round two. Bam. Scores the takedown, and then it's game over for Jalen Turner because the top control, the skill of the jiu-jitsu for Money Moicano is too good. And after the win, guys, the win wasn't only the highlight of Renato Moicano's evening. It was the fact that he gave one of the most exhilarating octagon interviews I've heard live. Ever. Renato goes fully, like, first of all, his English is next level, which honestly you just automatically give plus points considering he's a complete foreigner. He plays towards the crowd, guys, and when you play towards the crowd, and this will be a theme that I'll mention later, when you play towards the crowd, everybody loves you no matter what, because it understands that you're taking their perspective into consideration. Renato Moicano, after a round two submission win over Jalen Turner, making the comeback, going through adversity, going through fucking brutal physical pain in the round one, he goes to Joe Rogan. He said, "Joe Rogan, I'm going to start my own podcast. It's going to be Best in the Business. And for the first guest, I'm going to have you, Joe Rogan. Joe Rogan, you cannot turn this down right now. I want you. Everybody loves you, Joe Rogan. Joe Rogan, I want the money. I always here for the money. I got family to feed. I got dreams to do." And think about this, I'm just imitating this guy. He's actually off the top of the dome smoother than I am. But the one line that he says that gets my dick harder and that gets me to be a bigger fan than anyone else over Money Moicano is, "I cannot afford to lose." Who does this guy... Bro, he has harder hitting lines... Not harder hitting punches like Jeremy Stephen. He has harder hitting lines than Conor McGregor. "I cannot afford to lose." After the fight he had, like, after just going through the adversity, after, like, not getting finished and fucking fighting through all that and finishing Jalen Turner, I cannot afford to lose. I cannot afford to lose. Nah. Guys, Money Moichano going for the belt in 2024. He's going to get one more submission win at the end of this year, and then he's going to go for the belt next year. He's convinced me. Renato Money Moichano, congratulations. That was one of my favorite fights to watch during the whole UFC 300. Next up, we go into the prelims. That was to end off the early prelims. That's me going all correcto mundo for the early prelims. I felt like hot shit afterwards. I can't even lie to you. I was like, 1, 2, 4, 4. All right. But anyways, then we go into the prelims. All right. Prelims. We kick it off with Diego Lopez, who is an up-and-coming Brazilian savage. Haircut on fleek, tattoo over here. Dream, believe, mate, and make it happen. Yeah, that's what it's all about. And he goes against Sadiq Yusuf. And Sadiq, been around for a little bit in the UFC now. Definitely has quite a lot of experience. And definitely a strong brawler type of guy. But Diego Lopez, that savagery, that killer instinct is slightly unlike other. It's that school shooter type of fucking mentality where it's just like, you know, I'm fucking so quirky. I'm so fucking quirky, but it don't matter because I've got that killer instinct at the end of the day. And Diego Lopez has that, man. Diego Lopez, he's unstoppable. And I don't think for a while, for the next three of his matchups, they're still won't be such killers that can go against him. So Diego Lopez just making it stronger. UFC 3 win streak right now and looking quite fiery hot right now. Kyla Harrison. Fuck, I still don't know, guys. That's how shit of a podcast host I am. I still don't know. It was Kayla Harrison. But anyways, we're going to move past it. She runs through Holly Holm. And wins by submission in round two. Because when you're a gold medalist in judo, that's the type of skill you possess. You grab a hold of them and then you take them down. And just because of your trained strength that you have over decades and decades of throwing people around, you could just throw other people around better than anyone else in the world, and your muscles are just perfectly like designed at this point to fucking throw a person around. And Kayla Harrison threw Holly Holm around for a bit, and in round two she was able to get the freaking submission. And that's as simple as that. She has a very, very bright future in the UFC, considering this was her UFC debut. And she has so many accolades that point towards her potential skill set in the UFC and her skill set opposing to all the other women in the division. Like, this is just Ronda Rousey 2.0 in 2024. That's really what I think it is. New, stronger version. More advanced version. And that's all there is to it. And also, just a side note, I want all the future that I am romantically involved with, I want them to be built like Harrison, dude. That's the way I want my women to be built. Right there to there. That's the sculpt of what I want. Yeah, dude, that's it. I will not settle for less. That's amazing, dude. Fucking congratulations, dude, that women fucking can train their ass off to look like that nowadays. That's just fucking amazing. You gotta tip it at this point. But anyways, let's move on. Aljamain Sterling also has a pretty freaking amazing physical build. He went against Calvin Kattar at 145 in the featherweight. Oh, no, no, no. Sorry, not 145, 155. No, 145. The fuck am I talking about? Yeah, went up to 145 featherweight against Calvin Kattar. And this is when my picks started slowly going downwards. So I had predicted Diego Lopez. I had predicted Kayla Harrison. So I was 6-for-6, but this is when it started going, the streak of flawlessness had come to an abrupt end. Jalen Turner, he did what he had to do. He was the long, you know, African American that couldn't get it done, but also was heavier in weight. But now switch the books around, long limbs, heavy, still heavy for a division, really great at weight cuts, 145, Sterling. I thought Calvin Kattar was going to be like just slightly bigger than Aljamain, but Aljamain looked quite similar in size, to be honest with you, and Aljamain Sterling did what he did, grab hold of you, not let go, control you, 15 minutes, done. He proves that the skill that he has will easily be able to outskill other opponents no matter what the division is. That's as simple as that. Aljamain Sterling, absolute freaking savage. You cannot go wrong with this guy. It's just, you know, if he grabs hold of you, that's it. Sean O'Malley was able to work past that, but yeah, that's what happens when he grabs hold of you. So for future opponents, don't let the funk master get a hold of you, or otherwise it's not going to be too funky for yourself, okay? We go into the last fight of the prelims. Jiří Procházka, he shows off his warrior freaking mentality, dude. He shows off his killer instincts against another guy, against Alexander Rakic, who also has the same attributes, who also has the warrior mentality, also has the killer instincts, just on a slightly different way. Jiří Procházka, obviously a very unique character, unique personality, but however, that uniqueness is what gave Jiří Procházka the edge in the end. Comes back in round two. I say the comeback because in round one, Rakic was very effective and very dangerous throughout every single second of the first round. It was very nervous for me to be watching that. Jiří was getting his legs picked apart from Rakic's kicks, and Jiří, as best as he was switching stances, was not able to steer away from it. So going into round two, and the fact that he survived round one, going into round two, Jiří was, he took a deep breath and he understood that it was either he was going to get killed by those leg kicks and then he's just going to, you know, crumble, or he's just got to go in for the kill. And Jiří, like, he was floating, man, throughout the cage, just because he couldn't even walk properly. He had to kind of like not even take proper steps to be able to move forward or backwards or side to side. Shows off the killer instincts. Turns the mode on, catches Rakic more than once, stuns him, ground and pound, stuns him, ground and pound. Game over. Round two, comeback, goes through adversity just to show you he is coming back for the gold. He is nowhere out of the conversation yet. And that's how we end off the prelims and we go into the main card. The main card was kicked off by Bo Nickel. 3-0, three finishes in the UFC. Bo is a smart dude. Bo is not a dumb dude. Bo knows that this is a long run. Bo knows that he still has a long way to go. Bo knows that this will only help with confidence. 3-0 in the UFC, three finishes. Went into a second round, surprisingly, with Cody Brundage. I got to give Cody Brundage a shout out, because in round one, there was this one grappling exchange that was actually very impressive from Cody's side, considering how high level it was. You know, Bo Nickel's grappling is as high level as it gets. But anyways, just shout out to Cody Brundage for, you know, taking the matchup. Shout out to Bo Nickel getting the win, keeping his streak alive. I know that it won't hurt him, but and he's smart enough to understand that this ain't a delusion. He's all right. He's good to go. Charles Du Bronx. This is when we're the episode's gonna turn a little bit somber. It's gonna get a little bit more. The frequencies are gonna lower down a little bit. This is a little bit like we gotta take, you know, moment of for my brother Charles Du Bronx Oliveira. Last fight was against Benil Dariush, got rid of him in a spectacular fashion. Now went against Arman Tsarukyan. Arman coming in as the favorite in the fight. Definitely not an easy opponent. Nobody said that this was an easy matchup for Charles Du Bronx. However, everyone thinks very highly of Charles Du Bronx. So because of that, because the reason why this sucks is because it was close, guys. It was a split decision win to Arman Tsarukyan. Charles Du Bronx narrowly missed out on the win, and I'm talking narrowly. Charles did everything he could. He never got fricked up. There were moments where it got a little bit scary. Definitely was more on Armand's side, the fight, but it was so close, guys. Charles had two different chokeholds on Armand that if it was maybe a little bit angled slightly different, he could have possibly gone the win then and there, guys. And I'm not counting him out. Charles Oliveira, Charles Du Bronx Oliveira, the champion has a name, Du Bronx. We're going to bounce back because I genuinely think Armand, yes, might be on quite the similar level of like breaking into the top five, but any other guy other than Arman Tsarukyan, you throw out Oliveira, I'd like to see how that goes, okay? I'd like to see how that goes. So we're not going to go into this too deep. Round one analysis, round two, round three analysis. Guys, Charles Du Bronx, I know he's well. I know he's thankful either way. He tried his best. He didn't get fucked up. You know, this was just one of those tough split decision losses that happened. And great for Arman Tsarukyan for sure. He definitely proved that he is on another level, considering that Charles Oliveira has put away guys that I think are more dangerous than Armand, that are bigger names like Dustin Poirier, Michael Chandler, right? So very, very respectful for Armand Tsarukyan, and wonder who he's going to be matched up with next in the lightweight division. But let's move on to possibly, ladies and gentlemen, the fight of the night and the fight of the night for a very long time. Hold up, let me just adjust this real quick for y'all. It was for the bad motherfucker belt, and at this point I think if matchups keep on being like this, before revealing to you what has happened and whatnot, before going any further, I think if they keep on making the smartest and throwing the best possible matchups for the bad motherfucker belt, for the bad motherfucker title, this could be one of the most entertaining things in the UFC, because it's very unique to the UFC. You go to Bellator or you go to PFL, there's the heavyweight championship and there's the lightweight championship. The weight division thing, that's not unique, right? I know it's the weights and the all the other details of it and the classes, they're still unique in its own way, but it's just the weight class championship. That's not unique, but the bad motherfucker title is, okay? And for the first, they're slowly getting it. They're slowly getting it, which is amazing. You've seen it evolve. I've seen it evolve. It started with Jorge Masvidal versus Ben Askren. And what happened after that? It was one of the most viral knockouts still in the UFC, the flying knee from Jorge, right? And that was to kick off the bad motherfucker belt. And then after that, we had Jorge Masvidal versus Nate Diaz. And then, it was Jorge Masvidal versus Nate Diaz. And then after that, it was Jorge gave it up? Did he just give up the belt? Or something? Justin fought, but Justin got it. And then, yeah, Dustin fought Chandler for it. Yeah. No, Dustin. Yeah, Dustin fought Chandler for it. Dustin, why am I saying okay, now I'm just getting fucking names missed. Justin fought Chandler for it. Justin got it, fought against Poirier. And then knocks out Poirier. And then now went against Max Holloway. Max Holloway stepping up in weight division for the third time, has lost all the other fights when he stepped up to lightweight. Now again in lightweight, goes against the hardest hitting knockout artist in the lightweight division, Justin Gaethje. And it's a 5-round fight because it's for the bad motherfucker belt, right? And guys, for once, I really think the UFC put two badass motherfuckers. I think Dustin Poirier, no, you know what? Honestly, that fight was a badass motherfucker fight, but it, because of how it ended, everyone was just like, oh, Justin is just that powerful, and Dustin Poirier slipped. It was a little bit like, okay, well, yeah, Justin's a bad motherfucker, I guess. He kicks real fucking hard, right? But we never got like the full, like the badass, like badass. What's fucking badass? Badass is you could fucking take hits forever and ever, and both faces are bloodied up, and you still keep on going till the very last second. And that is exactly what happened after UFC 300. Badass motherfucker belt. They fought all the way down to the last second of the last round. Max Holloway and Justin Gaethje back and forth throughout the whole, all of the other rounds, okay? Arguably, Justin Gaethje outscored Max Holloway, okay, up until that point. What happens when you get two badass motherfuckers fighting for something that is called the badass motherfucker belt? Well, both of them are going to want to prove that they are the badass motherfuckers. They're not going to want to go away from the point or shy away from the opportunity of showing that they're badass motherfuckers. Because if they did that, they wouldn't be badass motherfuckers. So being the badass motherfuckers that they motherfucking are, Max Holloway, the number one badass motherfucker, pointed to the number two badass motherfucker, pointed down to the motherfucking octagon and said, motherfucker, let's go, motherfucker, to show off how badass motherfucker we are. Motherfucker. Max Holloway, in the last 15 to 10 seconds, points down on the octagon center with Justin Gaethje. Says, let's brawl it out. This is it. Brawl it out right now. Let's both show the world that we are badass motherfuckers. And let's show them what badass motherfuckers do. Well, shit, brother. Shit, in a situation where a badass motherfucker goes against a badass motherfucker, only one badass motherfucker gonna be the badass motherfucker. Buzzer beater, 1 second to go, round five of the last fight, of the last round. Max Holloway. Right overhand hook, however the fuck you want to call it, just snuck it in close like this. It wasn't like a like outwards. It was just, he ducked down. Bam. Justin Gaethje's chin was right there. Right here. Ducked down. Bam. Justin Gaethje, the badass motherfucker he is, falls down face first. Bam. Hits the canvas. Max Holloway, badass motherfucker of all time, wins the title, wins the badass bonuses for UFC 300. Shout out Max Holloway, man. Unbelievable. Unbelievable. Mind-blowing. And that's what entertainment is, ladies and gentlemen. That's what badass motherfuckers do. That's badass motherfucker. I've said it millions of times, badass motherfucker, but that's what and we've seen themes of that. That's what cool movies are. John Wick is a badass motherfucker, right? But this is real life. And think about how entertaining that shit is. Primetime entertainment for sure boosted UFC stock like crazy. Boosted their own stock, Justin Gaethje as well. I know it might have looked devastating. It sucks like, because I love Justin Gaethje. He's one of my favorite fighters. But how can you not root for Max Holloway after that? How can Max Holloway not be everyone's favorite fighter after that? Because how can you not look up to a badass motherfucker? Amazing, guys. Amazing. Like I said, people's main event, and they proved it, man. They proved it. How are you supposed to watch a fight after that? But we go into the co-main event, I guess. Zhang Weili, China versus China. I love it. It's China number one this episode, all day, every day. China is number one. But Zhang Weili goes against Yan Xiaonan, and another title defense for Zhang Weili, because she's trying to prove out there that this belt is just mine and no one can touch it. No one's going to get near it. I lost it once and I'm never going to lose it again. And that's how Zhang Weili is thinking. I know that's how she's training. I know that's the way it's going to be for a while. Yan Xiaonan showed tremendous perseverance. Shout out to both women. But Zhang Weili, I fucking love you. You're the best. You're the best. Why aren't you? You're the best. All right. And then we go into the co-main event. It's just, at this point, it was like, I was already like, I'm already tweaking. I'm like, there's just too much stimulation in my brain. Still can't imagine the fact that Max Holloway actually just did that. And then go into the main event, I guess. You know, light heavyweight championship of the world, Alex Pereira, Poatan, go against Jamal Hill. Jamal Hill talked a little bit of trash in the press conferences. Alex Pereira always, with his killer demeanor, silent killer demeanor. And you know what? You know, it ain't as complicated as you thought it was. So in round two, Jamal Hill gets a little kick going. And, you know, oh no, sorry, this is round one. Sorry, I'm tripping. Round one, Jamal Hill kicks a little bit, misses a little bit, and hits Alex Pereira's cup, but I guess it's because the angle was a little bit weird, like it didn't actually even affect Alex Pereira. So nut shot don't matter to Alex Pereira. He tells Herbteen it's all good. He's focused. They're literally face to face. Tells Herbteen we're good, because Herbteen noticed, like, heard the cup, and he was like, all right, let's take a pause. That was a nut shot. Let's take a pause. And then Alex Pereira goes like, don't worry about it. I'll take care of it. And then he gets back. The good old rusty hammer. The good old, hey. The old reliable. The h-tish, h-tish, h-tish. Left hook. Left hook all day. You get touched with that left hook, you're gone. You're gone. You're done. You got another left. You out. Peace out. On a motherfucker. It's done. You're done. Left hook. Douche. Catches Jamal Hill on the chin. And that's as simple as that. A little bow, 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 bow afterwards. And finally a title defense for Alex Pereira proved me wrong in the main event. And now we have lots of UFC lined up for the rest of the year. Now we know that at least based on UFC 300, Jiří Procházka is matching up with Alex Pereira at least for the light heavyweight championship. And then now we have Dustin Poirier versus Islam Makhachev June 1st in Newark with Sean Strickland and Paulo Costa as the co-main. And then we got Conor McGregor versus Michael Chandler at welterweight end of June. Are you freaking kidding me? The Notorious is back, baby. So that's the story of UFC, guys. I don't know what else to say. It's beautiful. I'm blessed. This is the UFC world. It's crazy, man. I'm glad that I was a part of it, and this is just wonderful. Keep it up, 300, and I'll be looking forward to 400 once it gets up on this motherfucker. But anyways, badass motherfucker. I just wanted to say it one more time. Those UFC guys, those are some badass motherfuckers. Anyways, let's get into Formula One, man. We took a break off. It was all good and dandy, but now we're back, and back in a big way. We're back in the motherland. We're back in the motherland. Shanghai. We haven't been there since, you know, this thing that allegedly, you know, like the thing that we can't even like physically see or anything, like, and it technically isn't even alive. It somehow, you know, was there first and then got out of there, and it kind of fucked the world up for a couple of years there. But anyways, we'll move past that. We're back. We're back. We're back. Let's move past that. Okay. It's all good. It's the first sprint weekend of the season. On a track that they haven't been on for 5 years. Make it make sense. You know, if I were a Chinese fan or a Chinese audience member, that's cool. But as a viewer out here, I'm going like, it's about to get crazy. I don't know how I feel, because in a way, the reason why I kind of like Formula One is because of, like, you know, you can, there's always like the basis of reference. You can kind of say, okay, this is kind of what's going to happen. But now sprint weekend, like sprint qualifying is on Friday, guys. They have one practice, then it's sprint qualifying, then it's the sprint, then it's, do they even have practice too? What the fuck, guys? This is craziness. Like, a lot of these drivers haven't even fucking driven in Shanghai other than in the simulators, guys. This is fucking crazy. So yeah, no, they have one practice, guys. They have one physical fucking practice on Friday, then they go sprint qualifying, then they go sprint on Saturday, qualifying for the race on Saturday as well, and then they have the race on Sunday. It's kind of crazy, kind of chaotic. I expect nothing. Like, this fight, I expect just, I don't even know what I expect. It's just, I think it's going to be chaos. I feel like a lot of guys are not going to be too strong on the track, just literally very confused trying it out. And then there's going to be another handful of guys who've just been driving it, and it's just second nature. Of course, they took a little bit of a break, but now they're excited to be back on a track that, you know, change of pace type of dealio, where it's just like, oh yeah, right, there was this track I kind of, yeah, you know, this turn was actually kind of fun, you know. And that's where you're gonna start seeing the fucking differences. Like, think about Oscar Piastri, Logan Sargeant, Joe Guan Yu, who else, all types of, dude, they haven't been there, guys. It's kind of fucking crazy. And this is when you're gonna see, like, think about Alonso and Hamilton, Bottas, like these guys have, or Perez, these guys have been driving Shanghai GP for a while. So you're truly going to see the fucking skill gap difference this weekend. Like, you almost can't shy away from it at all. And I don't think this will be a 1-2 or Red Bull 1-2 type of weekend, or any type of 1-2 weekend. Especially if Mercedes, McLaren, and Aston Martin, they're causing trouble throughout the sprint and all that shit, and trying to get a bit of an edge all throughout that stuff. So I really don't think it's gonna be difficult for Red Bull and Ferrari to kind of just focus on each other. So I think because of that, it's not going to be just a regular 1-2 anymore. And it's probably going to be the first one of the season, fingers crossed. And guess what? Zhou Guanyu for points. That's as simple as that. He's finally going to be able to drive at home in front of his home crowd. And, like, think about it. He's been in the F1 for so long. Finally able to drive at home. Like, think about how pissed he's been, since getting in the F1. All he's really wanted to do was drive at home. Now he's going to be able to drive at home. So let's hope for points for my boy Zhou Guanyu. And let's hope for a little bit of a Sainz P2 maybe. And Oscar Piastri podium. No, I'm kidding. Daniel Ricciardo points, maybe. This will be the last chance that I give Danny Rick before I kind of turn on him. Yeah. Lando Norris. George Russell is barely fucking driven there either. Like, George might. I don't know. It's going to be weird. I feel like this is finally going to be a race where Lewis Hamilton does a little something, because he really has been struggling. But I think now he's going to be back with a little bit more fire. But just, I could see Fernando Alonso being like top four this weekend, like, just because of the experience he has. So let's see what goes down. All right. Very excited to be back in the motherland. China number one for sure. And, I could end it here, but I just want to mention something real quick, because this is happening this weekend. I think it's a pretty big deal in terms of the sports world. So the NBA, finally the regular season closing down. We're finally getting into the playoffs. But since the COVID years, NBA, very smart, made a tactical decision. Let's make a tournament to see who actually makes the playoffs if the seeding is very, very close. So this is what they're doing nowadays. They're doing a play-in tournament to make the playoffs. And it's going to be going throughout Wednesday night, Thursday night. First, Lakers versus Pelicans, the 7th and 8th seed in the West. That means it's either LeBron James securing a spot in the playoffs with Anthony Davis and the Lakers boys, or it's Zion Williamson, Brandon Ingram, and those boys clutching up to make the playoffs, or the loser of this matchup has to go against the next matchup, which is the 9th and the 10th seed in the West, which is the Warriors and the Kings. So Warriors 9th seed, Kings 10th seed. The loser of the Warriors and Kings gets eliminated, and the winner goes against either the Lakers or the Pelicans. So this is actually very... And who's in the Warriors? It's Steph, dude. Steph might not make the playoffs right now. Steph or LeBron. Either Steph and LeBron both make playoffs, or they both can miss off, or one only makes it. So I actually think it's very, very interesting. Just in terms of the big names, I know this bandwagon is fuck. You only care about the big, but this is how it is, guys. Fuck you. I'm wearing Larry Bird. That's just because he was a goddamn legend, That's just, and of course, because of that, I've watched all his basketball. Stop dissing the fuck out of me, okay? Fuck you. Anyways, we go into the East. Flip it around. It's 76ers at 7th seed. It's the Miami Heat in 8th seed. Miami Heat, Jimmy Butler, with all the other, Tyler Herro, Bam Adebayo, and then you're going against 76ers, Joel Embiid, and those guys. Doc Rivers? Is that 76ers right now? Doc Rivers? Yeah, I don't know. Was it? I don't know. Fucking, yeah, they're trying to figure it out. And they're both very, very strong teams as well. At least the recent past two seasons. Hawks versus Bulls. Hawks in 9th seed. Bulls in 10th seed in the East. They're going against Trae Young, and they're going against the Bulls, Zach LaVine, all those guys. They've been fighting real hard to make it work. Alex Caruso, all those guys. So who makes it? I'm voting for Jimmy Butler. I really want Jimmy Butler to make it. And I also really want to see Atlanta just make it, because they've been having ups and downs, and I always feel like they turn it up a notch a little bit in the playoffs, at least Trae Young. So you like to see that. That's the play-in tournament. I'm going to be tuning in. I really want to watch Steph Curry kill it just so he can make the playoffs. I want to see LeBron. Everybody wants to see LeBron. And if we're talking about the playoffs and the NBA championship, then, well, shit. Dallas Mavericks, Luka Doncic, Kyrie Irving. I think they take it. I think it's simple as that. That's my shout-outs. Guys, great Ballin' At What Cost. Fun vibes. It's very simple. Great weekend coming up. I'm going to be tuning in. So will you. You better. Shanghai GP, China number one. You better show your love. But anyways, have a great weekend, guys. What a weekend we had. Seriously, just fucking, I still trying to process it all, and this is why I'm glad I fucking first thing Monday I had to get this out of my system, just a woo, whew, way more to come, but geez, not bad before the summer season and all that, before the halfway through mark of the year. So here we are, ladies and gentlemen, Ballin' At What Cost, week 16. I'll see you next week.